Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Annual Markets Webinar of 10th of July 2014. Today, Chris Forzik is with me, and we will show you how to trade candlestick patterns at Confluence. So, this is one of those webinars where you can find interesting because you can incorporate this into existing strategy also, and you can see how some traders did it back in time and how you can basically use Confluence, different Confluence for trading candlestick patterns. So before we begin, our standard risk disclaimer, risk disclosure statement stating all possible risks associated with Forex market. By accepting the risk, you're also proceeding further with us. Online educational materials are developed by Admiral Markets as Estonia for a global audience. Therefore, please take into consideration that information in this session may not be suitable for everyone. To get a corresponding information on charting conditions and any other detail, please visit www.admiralmarketsglobal.com, select your country of residence and contact an appropriate entity. And final part of risk disclaimer, Admiral Markets UK LTD takes no responsibility for the information accuracy. The analysis represents the personal opinion of the author, me and Chris, and in no way it represents the actual suggestion for the trade. These are not MUK's opinions. The website in the video is not the .co.uk website, but a globally used.com website. Forex is risky business, and this is a personal opinion only. This webinar is for informational and educational purposes only. Before we begin with the webinar, because I had a lot of questions today, I really couldn't respond to all of the questions, but I'm very glad if you made the money with this analysis. So guys, thank you for your comments. Thank you. And if you made money with this, I just hope you did, because euro dollar really dropped from this zone and it hit basically L5. So excellent if you made money, and I again need to use this opportunity to thank you. And for all of you who don't know, that is my personal method, which me and Chris were doing for a while. So it's Camarillo MACD, and basically all of those analysis is Camarilla MACD. So of course, if you use it also with your system, I'm very glad it helped. Well, what can I say about candlesticks? Candlesticks is something which I'm very fond of, especially if I use it with let's say reversal patterns. Reversal patterns are my favorites. Back in time, I was trading my own method also, but it was based purely on pivot points and candlestick patterns, and it was called practical naked trading. And some of the principles in practical naked trading are also applied to Camarilla MACD, and I also use these candlesticks in everyday analysis. Not so often, I need to say, but I use it just for spotting one additional confirmation for potential either a continuation or a reversal. Japanese candlesticks, needless to say, this is how candlestick looks. The body of the candle is usually the biggest, then we have upper shadow, which is the highest price, and lower shadow, which is the lowest price. This border presents opening or closing price, whichever is greater, and also this price is opening or closing price, whichever the less. So basically, you know about candlesticks. We had many different candlestick webinars so far. You already received the CPR indicator for spotting important reversals and continuation patterns. I can say not just important, but if you attended premium webinar where I presented CPR, you already have the indicator which can help you. I will show you also today one of methods how it can help you in finding confluence points with different pivot points. Needless to say, candlestick patterns are extensively used. Today, they're not maybe so strong, I need to say, as they were 5 or 10 years ago, especially during the first decade of 2000s. So that is because there are a lot of retail traders, a lot of stuff. It's the era of internet, and because of that, I only advise you to use those candlestick patterns on higher time frames. 1 hour, but most often it will be 4 hour and daily, but you can use it 1 hour. Below 1 hour, there are few systems which can be useful, but particularly 1 hour is used for intraday trading. Needless to say, candlesticks are not very useful on trading on 5 minute time frame. So I really don't know any method which is very effective in using candlestick patterns on 1 minute time frame. Really, I never saw that. So I think that I'm still that old school, and I still think that candlestick patterns are more important on higher time frames. So if you trade intraday, usually your time frame of choice will be 1 hour. If you want to trade intraday but also intra-week, then you usually will trade 4 hour time frame. Daily and higher time frames are just, they're not generally trading time frames. They're more of investment trading. Because if you trade a weekly or monthly time frame, that it has to do with investing more than trading. And it's, I don't find it useful, because I'm intraday trader and I really never traded such high time frames, weekly or monthly. It takes too much time to develop, and especially those swing traders are due to high volatility. Swing traders are really endangered if they use swing systems on high time frames. So I still am a pupil of that intraday trading, and I really love to trade intraday. And you can judge that from different analysis which you've been reading each day on Admiral Markets, Forex Factory, Twitter, so on, even now on Forex Street also. Candlestick patterns, a few words about candlestick patterns. Munehisa Homa was inventor of candlestick patterns in the 18th century, and back in time they didn't have any computers, and they were trading manually. And what did they do? They traded rice, and Homa invented candlestick patterns. So he's a pioneer of candlestick patterns. That is why we call those patterns Japanese candlesticks, because Japanese are really pioneers in trading candlestick patterns. Americans or Western world, I need to say, those are pioneers of bar trading, and today we basically use price. So for me, I'm not interested so much about the close of candlestick. I'm more interested to see the price. So that is the advantage of price action trading. But candlesticks are also embodiments of price action trading, and they are really useful if you know how to trade with it. So today's webinar will be about showing you how to trade candlestick along with Confluence, because you cannot just trade candlesticks as they appear. You need to know pivot points. Pivot points are very, very important. You need to know daily resistance levels, monthly resistance levels, weekly, monthly pivot points, and all of those things will make for a Confluence, and you can trade more safely than without it. The principles of emotions and psychology are used in making of candlesticks, because candlesticks in themselves are holding the complete sentiment of market per time frame. And also you can see the psychology of traders which use candlestick patterns. Steve Nissen also was a presenter of Japanese candlestick to Western world. So Steve Nissen is also one of pioneers who presented Japanese candlesticks to Western world. Well, I need to say that all of those patterns which Steve Nissen presented in his books and also online materials, all of those candlesticks can be spotted by the indicator which you probably got by now. And even though if you don't know all the patterns, you still can use different reversal patterns to trade off support and off resistance. Because basically, Japanese candlesticks are usually used in confluence with important support and resistance levels. So trading and buying off the support and selling close to resistance is the primary goal and the primary method when we use it in confluence. Those are some examples. I will not go through all of those candlesticks, because we have, me and Chris were presenting you 48 different candlestick patterns through all of these webinars, and also on the special webinar, premium webinar, when I presented CPR candlestick patterns. I presented you again all of those candlestick patterns which can be spotted and can be found on Forex Market Trading. And because of that, I will just show you how those candlesticks, some of them look like. And basically, by default, white is bullish, black is bearish. And that is, you know how candlesticks work, how they look like, and I will, of course, be fast with this part. What I'm interested in is to show you three different methods, and Chris will continue after me. So, three different methods for basically trading candlesticks with a confluence. Now, what is the confluence, guys? I don't know if you know the word confluence. The accent is different. Some people says confluence, some people says confluence. I say confluence. So that is basically when two or three important things are met in the same line. So those can be Fibonacci. You know how I trade. I will show you the example. This is the confluence, point of confluence. This is the confluence of double trend line, inner trend line, and H3 Camarilla level. So this point, POC zone, is confluence. Also on this chart, we can see a confluence of previous buyers, which are indicated here, now turned sellers, which are indicated by the break of inner trend line. And all of that makes a confluence. So previous near-term historical sellers, inner trend line, H3, and double trend line make confluence. So that is confluence. Today, I will show you confluence of candlestick pattern, especially pin bar, namely pin bar and Bollinger Band, then confluence of bullish and bearish engulfing with SMA, and confluence of reversal candlestick and pivot points. So that will all be according to the name of webinar, finding confluence points with candlestick patterns. Okay, so today this will be the subject: pin bars and Bollinger Bands confluence, bullish and bearish engulfing pattern with SMA confluence, and reversal candlestick and pivot point confluence. Okay, so you know now what confluence is, because many people are asking me POC, what POC is. Basically, it's a confluence of multiple factors which act as a unity, one for all and all for one. Basically, POC is my entry zone. For all of you who still don't know what POC is, when I make the analysis, I always put POC, and POC is my entry zone on that particular pair which I may trade, or I've been trading, or I'm trading. So that is POC. Now, of course, this webinar will show you a confluence of candlesticks with different indicators. So pin bar and Bollinger Bands trading. Now you should try to capture the screen, because I will be showing you 4-hour and daily, major currency pairs, indicators, everything. So try to memorize. Time frame is 4-hour and daily. Major currency pairs, you know what major currency pairs are. Euro dollar, or the cable, dollar Swiss, dollar yen. So you can trade those pairs with this strategy, or you can use this strategy to complement your own trading. Indicators which you will use is pin bar. You don't need indicator for pin bar. I will show you what pin bar is. And Bollinger Bands on default settings. Rules for long are simple. Pin bar above Bollinger Band but close inside it. Rules for short: pin bar below Bollinger Band but close inside it. Target price close to middle line, stop loss above, below last swing high or low. So this is one of primary methods how Bollinger Bands were traded. Now many traders add additional filters in this kind of strategies. They can add the CCI, they can add divergence, they can add RSI, stochastic, whatever. But one of primary basic methods how you can use Bollinger Bands and pin bars is this. You should look for a pin bar then closed inside Bollinger Bands. There is usually a sign of a possible fake breakout. So in this example, we can see that indeed the price has penetrated through Bollinger Bands, made a pin bar. This is pin bar. You see the pin, and the pin needs to be much longer than the body, with small or no wick at all, but preferably with a small body, and then the close inside of Bollinger Bands. After the price closed, you can see that it dropped lower. I mind you, however, this is 4-hour time frame, so the targets are slightly bigger. This example also is a form of pin bar, but I made that example because you won't be trading this. Because if you see this, this is not a valid pin bar. Pin needs to be much longer than the body. Even though next pin is shown here, you wouldn't be trading that because basically this is high momentum trading. So I advise you to trade with high momentum. But nonetheless, high volatility. You remember high volatility trading from yesterday. If you remember, we had a long demo trade with high volatility trading, and I will show you that next time. So basically, this is how it looks like. It's also pin bar, and it closed inside these bands, but the volatility is high. Although you can see that the target has been hit also here. This example is a good pin bar, big pin, the body is small, and then again the target has been hit. Same here. You can see how candlestick patterns are basically making a good confluence. Look at this also. This was a drawdown, but if you place your stop there, you wouldn't be in a profit here. This is perfect pin bar. So mind you to see this. So this is the perfect pin bar. If you see this kind of pattern, so this is usually a no-brainer trade. Look at this. Even at this point is a pin bar. This point is pin bar. This is a perfect pin bar. And you see how price behaved after it touched, it broke through Bollinger Bands and then closed inside it. So this is primarily method. Now, I don't say you can, I'm not saying that you should or you can, or you maybe be using this strategy in the future. But the thing is, this strategy will help you in creating your own system, which we will have a webinar about it. And also it will help you to define proper levels of support and resistance, and to know whether those resistance or supports are fake or true. Because in all of these examples, we can see that after the candlestick penetrated and closed inside it, basically the price went in the opposite direction. So this is how primarily Bollinger Band trading is. Those are the basic rules of Bollinger Band trading. And along with pin bar trading, it can really make a nice confluence. So pin bars and Bollinger Bands. Now, bullish and bearish engulfing versus SMA. We have basically 1 hour and above bigger time frames. We should be trading major currency pairs plus euro and or GBP miners. So major currency pairs plus euro miners and GBP miners. Indicators which we will use is only bullish engulfing and bearish engulfing pattern. So you don't need indicator for that. You know what bullish engulfing and bearish engulfing are. SMA 1 and 20. So only SMA 1 and 20 should be present on your charts. Rules for long. Body of the bullish engulfing exceeds the body of large bearish candle. And SMA 1 is higher than SMA 20. Rules for shorts. Body of the bearish engulfing exceeds the body of last bullish candle. And SMA 1 is lower than SMA 2. TP is discretionary or at next support or resistance level. And stop loss is always above and below last swing high or low. So this is how you can add this also strategy. And you can see that this is a confluence of moving average and candlestick. So in this point, we have a confluence of bearish engulfing. You see the body of this candlestick completely ate the body of previous bullish candlestick. So for a proper setup to be valid, for short setup, we should have a bearish engulfing, but previous candle should be bullish. So this candle is bullish, and this candle after it is bearish engulfing. Okay? And at that setup, you can see that basically the price went down. Okay? This is the next example. One SMA is above 20 SMA. This bullish engulfing ate previous candle, and you can see where the price went. To determine target price, you can put, basically you can make all of those important wicks as mini resistance or mini supports. And price will always be pulled magnetically towards these zones. This example also, you can see the previous bullish candle, this is engulfing candle, but because support was very, very close, you see in this example, this wasn't a successful entry. This is a good entry. Again, one SMA above 20. You can see that this body of this candlestick ate previous candlestick, so this is bullish engulfing pattern, and you see where the price went. Probable targets for this move are this level here, this level here, and this level here. And all of those levels have been hit afterwards. This is also unsuccessful bullish bearish confluence, and this example is successful bullish and bearish confluence. So we using only this strategy on this example, we had 1, 2, 3, 4 successful and 2 unsuccessful trades. But still, you can see how confluence with this works. So this is how confluence with this works. This is not bearish engulfing. We need to see bullish, on bullish examples, we need to see first bearish candle, which is eaten by bullish candle afterwards. And on bearish example, we should see, first we should see basically that bearish candle ate previous bullish candle. So that is how engulfing pattern and SMA do work. And next example is reversal candlestick patterns, all of reversal candlestick patterns, and pivot point confluence. For that you can try it on 30 minute and 1 hour time frame, but most successful trading is on higher time frames. But also it works on 30 minute. Major currency pairs can be traded in Euro and GBP miners. Indicators which you should be using are premium webinar indicators, CPR for reversal patterns, pivot point indicator, so daily pivot point from premium webinar, and monthly and weekly pivot point. For monthly and weekly pivot point, you can find those indicators freely on the internet, monthly and weekly pivot point indicators. So you should use CPR and daily pivot point indicator from premium webinar. Traders should always search for confluence of pivot points. So the first rule is you need to see a confluence of daily pivot points and or monthly and weekly pivot points. That is how confluence works. Rules for long, reversal pattern of the support confluence. Rules for short, simple, reversal pattern of the resistant confluence. Target price is next support resistance level and stop loss above or below last week high or low. So this is the example. This is the indicator which you were given. And you can see where confluence is. This is where confluence is. This is where confluence is. And this is also where confluence could be if we had a level. But because we don't have any level, confluence is this. Confluence is this, confluence is this. So for the confluence to be valid, we should have maximum 10 pips inside of confluence zones. So 10 pips between daily support and monthly pivot points. So between these two lines, there should be 10 points maximum. Well, 11 or 12, it's okay, but you should stick to 10. Eves is asking, hi T, I don't have the indicator, do I send a mail to support? Yeah, you should send mail to support, Eves, and they should give you CPR indicator and daily pivot point indicator, okay? Also, you can see this. This is confluence of pivot point and daily support. This is also confluence of monthly resistance and weekly resistance. So when candlestick pattern shows around there, you can go for a short trade. Below this on support, you go for long trades. This is inverted hammer of monthly pivot point and daily pivot point. You can see it here. And this is three outside up of daily and monthly pivot confluence. That is where this indicator can help you, really. It can spot different reversal patterns of the pivot points and of the support and resistance levels. So daily pivot points with monthly pivot points and weekly are making one confluence, as we can see here. And this is another confluence of monthly resistance and weekly resistance. So basically, as 1 hour trading can be efficient with this, but you need to be patient. Patience is always needed, but you have more than 10 pairs to trade with this, so probably you can see signals every day. And basically, this is all what I was planning to show you. Chris will continue with showing next confluence zones. So pin bar and Bollinger bands, bullish and bearish engulfing with SMA, and reversal candlestick at pivot point confluence can help you. They can be used as a standalone strategies if you are patient enough. But if you have mastered, I don't know, one of method of your own methods, or you are learning one of those methods, these kind of things can help you. But I still mind you, this is price action dimension. So if you want to trade it with price action systems or price action indicator combined system. And because of that, I don't advise you putting a lot of indicators below these kind of charts. As you can see, candlesticks are embodiment of price action, and using many indicators with price action is not recommended. You can use one, maximum two indicators, but for your sake, do not crowd your charts with different indicators. You will not get anything with that, believe me. So guys, this is everything what I wanted to show you. Now Chris will continue, and Chris will show you his way of trading confluences and showing you how you can spot also various candlestick pattern with confluence zones. Guys, thank you for listening to me. Chris will continue, and I will talk to you very, very soon, guys. Cheers.
Good evening, everyone. Let's take a look at my part of this presentation, candlesticks at confluence. So confluence, yeah, very important way of trading, especially if you trade discretionary. Great to have that confluence, because it's indeed many multiple eyes are looking at the same spot, therefore, of course, increasing the probabilities of a trade panning out. Obviously, if you have a 38.2 fib, a weekly S1, you have a previous top there, and maybe a L3, and lots of inspiration, but a trend line maybe, for instance, there's more reasons for a bounce. So confluence is a great way to trade discretionary, because it just increases the confidence and the likelihood of a trade panning out. So that's why we thought it was a good topic for today. And then, of course, looking for some candlesticks at that confluence gives that extra confirmation that price is indeed stopping there, because we could have a lot of confluence, but sometimes price does accelerate and push through support and resistance. Waiting for those candlestick patterns that Nenad already talked about is a good way to know that price is indeed pausing there. And that, of course, helps with not following the metaphorical falling knife, as they call it sometimes in trading, when trading against momentum. When you trade, for instance, fibs, then you potentially are trying to catch that falling knife. That's knife. That's what is often said with fib traders. So one way of avoiding that danger is trading with candlesticks, because they do show the potential for price to respect those levels. You know, in general, the candlesticks, as T already said, hourly has a bit more value, obviously, in a 4 hour than a 15. And lower than 15, I really haven't looked at myself. So that's the same thing for myself. First thing we can take a look at is candlesticks at pivot points. We actually look at this, I won't expand too long about this because Ned already talked about it, and we look at it anyhow in our strategy webinars on Wednesday. But the idea indeed being that if you have, for instance, confluences of pivot points that you could see, for instance, a bounce at that level. Well, today we had a good example of the pound yen, for instance. Excuse me. I have a bit of a throat problem after yesterday's World Cup match between Holland and Argentina. Obviously we have a confluence between weekly and daily pivot point, for instance. So you can look for some price action at that to have an idea that there is going to be a reversal. Now, on the 4 hour, we don't have it. On the hourly, we really don't have it except a harami here maybe an engulfing here. So, you know, it's not going to be perfect every single time. Obviously, there's a good resistance there, a good confluence at that spot in the pound yen once again, because we have a weekly and daily pivot point there. So this one broke actually to the downside before our trading room, so didn't look at it because it was already had broken, in my opinion, and I don't like to chase trades, but actually did go for a substantial run still after that. This is an example of that confluence, at least, and there's a harami here. Sometimes if I don't like a particular price action signal that much, like this harami in the middle is not really a strong signal, in my opinion, it's more like a doji, then I sometimes wait for bottoms to break instead of taking any candlesticks, because then you get the confirmation of a breakout. So that would be same method, but different entry potential. Let me see if there's another example to find. Let's see. We had a bull doji, for instance, here, or shooting star we discussed yesterday. Here we had, the shooting star is the best, actually. We had a weekly, daily, monthly pivot point. I wasn't too fond about this setup because of the expected downside was limited, in my opinion, before we would get upside. As I said yesterday yesterday. But it was a shooting star at that confluence of pivot points, so it is a good example that you can look at. So obviously, you can use your own eyes or a indicator for those candlestick patterns. Obviously, you can use a pivot point indicator to see confluence between those levels, and use an hourly or 4 hour to find that those setups. And the entry could be upon the close of the candlesticks, or even the break of the low, or the retracement of or the retracement of the candle. Right, the entry, in my opinion, is not fixed to a very specific form. Some people do that. I think it's just to make trading simpler for people who are learning trading. But in general, you normally have different ways of tackling an entry. There's not, usually speaking, only one entry. Reversals are more tricky, I would say, with entries, and maybe more limited in how you can enter. With good profit potential, but in general, I wouldn't limit strategy to only one entry, because the market is just so many ways of looking at it. There are definitely multiple ways. So these are two great examples, in my opinion. But just in case, maybe one more. Your odd here, for instance, had one today, shooting star close to this monthly pivot point at the daily R2. That's a confluence between two pivot points, the monthly pivot and the daily R2. So that could be, that is a potential. You know, if you like it or not, if you see things that might not be that good for that trade, it doesn't have to be taken necessarily, but it is an example. And if you trail stop, it depends how you want to trail stop, but if you trail stop each candle high, then you're not doing too bad at the moment. So that's another example. Let me think if there are more examples today. Not really. I think Euro New Zealand was a breakout trade. It was a moving average trade, so that's a bit different. We can keep that one for later in this session. Oh, the pound, actually. Sorry. The pound dollar weekly pivot point price moved back to the weekly. We discussed this today, saying that it can bounce at the daily or the weekly. So if you look at the hourly, we had Harami here just below the weekly, but that would still be considered a support, in my opinion, although we just punched through it a bit. So it isn't really moving up that much, but it wouldn't be a loss either if you wait for that Harami at the weekly pivot point. So those are the examples of pivot points. I won't go into that longer. Let's move on to moving averages, candlestick and moving averages. Let's take a look at this Euro New Zealand. So we see here, first of all, 4 hour a strong downtrend on the moving averages, and the hourly showing the same. You can see this purple line is the 4 hour moving averages roughly. So that's pointed down. Then we have the 1 hour band. This is, I'll tell you the EMAs I'm using here in this case 21 EMAs, high, low, and close, and then 89 close. And additional 3 and 8 EMA close. And you see here a classical breakout scenario where price moves back to moving averages and continues today, right? You see price moving back to moving averages and then using it as resistance and moving down. So using that as an entry would have been good. Actually, if you wait for the close below that band, it would have been this candle. I was already looking for a break a bit earlier, I believe, but let's zoom in. I was looking at the 50-minute chart, to be precise. And you can see that here are hookbacks to the moving averages, and you see candlestick patterns at those moving averages. It is a 50-minute chart, but you can see the rejection there. Euro New Zealand is actually the best example today. But the Euro Yen could have worked as well, both for the pivot points as the moving averages. Let's see, here at Harami at the weekly. And here you see price breaking below, well, it's not an example, it's a breakout more, where price is breaking below the moving averages. But let's scroll back just a bit, and you see, for instance here, price breaking away from moving averages, price breaking back up to it, and what do you see here? Engulfing. Now you're not going to see a ton of candlestick patterns at moving averages, but if they occur like this, shooting star, engulfing, you could see follow through sometimes. Now this is an example where you don't get it, Harami there, but you get upside follow through, so it doesn't work always. You might want to look for extra confluence, for instance, of the AO. If you see divergence between these bottoms, this one might be dangerous. Suram, certainly. This is not the only EMA combinations I use. For those that are in my strategy and live trading webinars, you know that. But I use Fib numbers, basically. They're all Fib numbers. I will write that down, though, no problem. Now, the 3 and the 8 are good to have an indication of what's going on in the short term. Here, for instance, you have engulfing at the moving averages, but what you can wait is for price to break below the 21 band and for the 8, the 3 to cross the 8. In that case, you can enter here instead. Okay, so that's how I play around with entries and trail stops, depending on the case-by-case situation. I like to trade with that discretion personally, but obviously, of course, you don't have to trade with that discretion. But I'm more of a discretionary trader. So for me, these are just tools that I use, and you know, there could be a confluence. I have engulfing here, and I see indeed the break below. Plus, of course, the downtrend in play. So these are things that you can think of. Let me see if I can find an example. One more example. Let me think for a second which pair could be good to look at. Here, the Aussie here. It was a slow grinding upside, I grant you that, but still, Harami here, for instance, at the moving averages, is an example of, you know, price bouncing off moving averages. Right, so that you can use when you see Harami at that, it is possible to take that trade right there, or wait for the 3 to cross the 8 and a close above those moving averages. That would be this one instead of this one, right? Or use both, you know, both these elements to confirm each other. So I hope I was, you know, if you have any questions, because I realize that this is a lot of info that is maybe happening quickly. By all means, please ask me, because I don't have the info maybe as nicely summarized as Nenad has in his PowerPoint. I'm just showing on the chart, so that could be maybe more confusing. Let's see, Eve, as long as they break confluence, right? As long as, in this case, the moving averages, it's looking for a bounce, not so much as a break, but you could look for a break. You know, after the price bounces at the moving average, you could look for a break above. Maybe that's what you mean. Yeah, that's true. So, you know, we had the bounce at the moving averages, and then it breaks with this candle. It breaks with the red dot. It breaks above it again. True. Confluence of pivots. Yeah, that's the other way to look at it, indeed. You could look, well, I was looking more as a bounce. For instance, we were looking at the euro dollar, right? So yeah, you have confluence there, and I'm looking for a bounce at that, for the opposite direction, in fact. If price is going to the pivots, I'm looking for price to stop there and reverse back. But if it breaks above it, then, you know, and then hooks back to it, then of course it can become support again. So then I would look for upside indeed. So it depends from which angle price is approaching it. The same thing could be done for candlesticks at Fibonacci. When you have Fibonacci, you don't want to catch the falling knife, and you don't want to assume that the price would stop at the 50 Fib. Then here too, you can use the candlestick indicator to show, or your own eyes and candlestick pattern knowledge to know, of course, or to see which Fib would be used. Now, that is a bit difficult, more difficult. Fibs are just a bit more difficult because it's up to us which leg of swing high, swing low we use, we actually choose. That requires more experience. Pivot points are there day in, day out, and are not changed by us. They're automatically plotted there, and there's advantage in that. Knowing which swing height or swing low, actually we don't know, but you know, trying to estimate what the best swing high, swing low is does require a bit more art in a way, a bit more science, a bit more knowledge, a bit more experience. It's not something that can be learned, I would say, from one day to another. Pivot points are there. It doesn't matter who looks at it, they'll be the same. Not every pivot point calculator is the same, or the pivot point spot will be the same, but it's not something that we have to manually discretionarily change. Doesn't mean that fibs are not good. They could still be good as a confluence, if you like, with other things, if you don't feel as confident to use only fibs. The pound dollar is an excellent example. Why is that? Because if you look at the fib here that I have, you have this swing high, swing low, and price stopped at the 38.2 and then the 50 fib. Those are bouncing spots. So you can look for candlestick patterns at those levels. Now, we didn't get really candlestick patterns. We maybe had engulfing here. It doesn't show up on the indicator, though. Retracement of that candlestick pattern could have been a bouncing spot. Or we had actually, we had actually Harami here. I didn't zoom in close enough, sorry. At that 50 fib. That would be a potential for that idea. All right. Candlesticks at oscillator turns when the price has gone back to the zero line. Let's take a look at that. Oscillator AO, I think, is very valuable for when price has made a retracement. For instance, you can read here, you can see that there's momentum to the upside. Price is moving, is above the zero line, indicating the upside momentum. So if price then goes back to that zero line, which indicates that the retracement has been completed, you can look for candlestick patterns to show that that particular direction is back in play. Let's take a look. Here, for instance, what do we have here? We have this upside swing. Price is above the moving averages, if you like that as a confluence. Moreover, you see that this is going in a corrective consolidation or a contracting wedge, which is a chart pattern, right? And you see a bet hold line candlestick pattern, totally engulfing the previous candle. Well, closing above the moving averages, and well, that, you know, obviously at that point could be the signal to potentially think about a long, and that didn't do too badly, as we can see here. All right. Let's take a look. Now, obviously, I'm not saying that this is never going to fail, but let's take a look. You need to make sure that you're trading with the momentum, okay? Now, these dips, I wouldn't be too sure that this is trading with the momentum. So looking for candlestick patterns here, and here you see did work out, but may not be the best ones because there's not a lot of momentum to the downside. There seem to be more upside momentum, in fact. So looking for engulfing here or Harami here could make sense. In fact, you can see that both sides of the table had actually potential. The candles, bullish candlestick patterns and the bearish ones won, though. And then you see bearish candlestick patterns at moving averages as well, as we discussed in the previous ones right here. So those are just a couple of examples. Let's see if there, let me think which could be a different pair that's good to show. The euro yen maybe is a good one, yes. Well, so, but not bad. It did break with some momentum. I wouldn't say that the AO has a ton of momentum, but okay. It did have some momentum, obviously, here, and we did get a Harami when the AO was back to the zero line. So that would have qualified too, plus is at the weekly pivot point. So you see, as we take it step by step, we're bumping automatically into confluence, right? We talked about pivot points 20 minutes ago. Now we're talking about AO. And what do we see? We see that the same setup occurred at the same spot. What does that mean? Confluence. Right, so there's that supporting element between the AO and the pivot point. Now, when we were looking at this setup, we only looked at the pivot point, and we didn't look at the AO. Now you can see there's an extra confluence, in fact. let's see if there's another example. Here, Harami. AO back to the zero line. This was a momentum AO strong. Now, you know, how you know what the AOF is, the AOF is strong or not, is something that you'll just have to really get a feeling for. I do not give a certain value to the AO top or bottom. I just look at it relatively speaking when comparing AO tops and bottoms to each other. I do not want the minimum necessarily to get a minimum level. But in my opinion, this was a nice upside momentum, and therefore this, when this got back to the zero line, and this Harami was one that qualifies. Also, this downside qualifies too. This was a nice downside momentum. Therefore, when it got to the zero line, we saw shooting stars. There's nothing wrong with shorting it there, in my opinion. The short didn't go too far before we bounced into support. Therefore, I would use a trade management style that I would not lose on this trade anymore. What can you think of? Well, if you use the hourly tops and bottoms, for instance, and I wouldn't go right one pip below it, but you know, 10, 15 pips is probably a decent amount. Then you see that, you know, the stop loss would have been around the entry point, so that would have been about break even. Especially if you enter here at the candle close and you put a stop loss about 5 pips above it, you know, the stop loss is only 11 pips. So if you're up 30 and you're up 3-1, or I'm up 3-1, I'm not going to risk any of that risk. That doesn't make sense. So actually, if I'm up 3-1, I would drill stop this one tighter, really above this candle highs here. We've got three highs. There's no way I would give more than that. And then actually, when you get that, that short didn't go too far before we then see the momentum shift to the upper side. But that's something, of course, that we don't know necessarily with this particular AO strategy. AO is looking for a momentum, and we had it to the downside. So that was a good signal. That we didn't get follow through is nothing, you know, we can't control the market. It's nothing we can do about that fact. Still not a bad trade, though. This one was better, though, obviously. So if you use candlestick low, then, and 15 pips, then an exit would have been probably actually all the way at the top here at 139.01. So yeah, that would be good. Let me find a bad one. I don't want to seem like I'm only giving winning ones, which is not my intention. You know, if the oscillator is doing this up and down with small waves like that, there's no momentum, right? So one could consider this maybe still an upside momentum. So if you take, yeah, this inverted hammer could be still an option, although it did go our ways, so it's not that, not a bad example. Let me see. Well, here you got a strong AO reading. You got to move back to the zero line, and you see Harami here, for instance. Let's dive into that part here. You see advanced block and Harami. So you can see that would have been actually a losing example, because if you put the stop loss above those highs, price went 3 pips above it. So I wouldn't use, as you can see, you know, the reason why I don't exactly go above it, because otherwise it's a loss. I do use 5-7, usually speaking, depending on the candlestick pattern, by the way. These two do not look that seriously bearish to me, although they, according to the indicator, are showing candlestick pattern formations. They are not signaling a close that is very bearish, because the close is about halfway that candle, which makes the stop loss or the placement above the stop loss above these highs very disputable. And you can see we did get a break by 3 pips, and then we finally moved down. So depending on where the stop loss is, that first one could be a loss. But if you use 5-7, you're safe on that, and you still get the downside. Or if you take the Harami, you're still safe. Candlesticks at stochastics are oversold and bought. This is something I might use as a confirmation. It's not something I use as a standalone, though, but I wanted to mention it. For instance, here, if you have divergence between these tops, it would be more of a reversal idea when you see Harami like that right there at that divergence. Personally, I'm not really a big trader like that who does that. But you know, something that I know traders use. You can see also the divergence between here, the stochastics as well, in the most recent higher highs, not only between these tops, but the most recent tops here as well. So that would be that, and candlesticks at fractals and time factor. Well, what do I mean with that? This is a bit more complicated to explain maybe, but let me see if I can find a good example. I found an example. These examples are not prepared, by the way. It's just at random. But here you see, for instance, downside. And you see 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth candle not breaking the low. I have a time factor rule that is looking for 5 to 8 candles not breaking a higher low. That indicates a substantial chance in my research and opinion that the momentum is finished. So if that happens and we get a fifth candle that is engulfing, all right, at the fifth one, that means my time factor rule has been met and I have a candlestick pattern, and that could be a long. Now this long didn't go anywhere, but that doesn't matter because the trade management side takes care of that. Because if I see that many candles that don't go anywhere, I'm definitely going to move it to break even, and it would be a break even trade. There's nothing wrong with that. In fact, you might even, I mean, potentially close in reverse. Why would anyone think about that? Because 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6th candle that didn't break this high. I think it's a bearish candle. Well, it actually says, not sure now, it's a green arrow and a red arrow at the same time. Well, in any case, if you look at the other things, of course, if you would look at the moving averages, what do you see? You see the moving averages kick in, and you see a potential resistance here. So if price then starts to break below it, like this candle, obviously that could be a good breakout trade. Or if you see a candlestick at those moving averages, like this shooting star, that too could be an entry. So you got, this was the counter trend idea that didn't go anywhere though, and it's almost like a potentially close to a close in reverse or near it for that with the trend set up again. That's what I mean with candlestick patterns. Time factor in that regard. It could also be used for an exit, by the way, to exit the short, any short that was here, potentially. I don't have a lot of examples on this euro yen. At the moment, well, here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 candle shooting star, and then you did get the downside. But so that was another confluence. Harami at the pivot, the AO back to zero line, and then you had the five candle rule. So look at the confluence now on this euro yen. We started with the Harami at the weekly pivot point. Then we added the fact that the AO was there. Then we added the time factor, and you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 candles to shooting star. The moving averages are the only thing that are not aligned, in fact, but that you have those aligned with this bearish candle, in fact, when it breaks below it. So those are the things that I wanted to mention for today's trading candlesticks at Confluence. I hope you didn't mind this discretionary explanation. If you have questions, please, I'm available. Please let me know. I gladly help or try to clarify. I think that these are strong, very useful tools, at least in my opinion, for my trading. They are very valuable. I like them a lot. I think they're great ways of trading, and I think they make trading fun and nice to look at. Now, of course, if that is something for you, it really depends on your own strengths and weaknesses and your style, in a way, to a certain degree. In the meantime, if you have questions, let me know. But I will continue and show you that next week we have webinars again. We have webinars on Monday, weekly FX recap, and we have live trading labs on Tuesday and Thursday, and strategy on Wednesday. That's fully focused on strategy on Wednesdays, a webinar on Wednesday. And then we have expert opinion on Wednesday with regard to Nenet, who's taking a look at low volatility trading. Now next week we got Do You Make the Best Trading Decisions on Thursday. I seem to have scared off some traders in the meantime. Maybe it was too much info too fast, but if you have any questions, by all means, once again, let us know. But don't forget to take a look at not only our webinars, as I stated, basically Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday evenings, and Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday mornings, 6 webinars a week. But also take a look at the Admiral Market spreads, but also our Admiral Market social media that is useful. In the meantime, who do you think is going to win the final, Germany or Argentina? Suram had the same question in mind, and is sad about the Holland loss last night. I join you in that comment. I was very, very sad. I still am, actually. Well, it's just a game, I know, but still, it is a hard blow because I expected really Holland to make it. Gave them a 90-95% chance, almost ridiculously high, I guess. But but what can you do? I think Argentina does not have really a great team. I'm not sure how they made it, but they show character by, in a way, of course, by being so disciplined. That's for sure. But attractive-wise, attacking-wise, it doesn't have much meat around the bone, this team. So I think it's going to be Germany. I have little doubts, to be honest, that Germany's going to make it. But you never know. Argentina, far from impressed me. Totally not. Not at all. Every match was a struggle for them. So, but you know, they made it, so you never know. Germany, of course, didn't impress every match either, but they did make a 4-0, 7-1. So they do have a bit more organized, I think, approach and better attack. Well, maybe or not organized, but a better better combination and attack, primarily. I think both are very organized teams, though. That's why I think Holland had it so difficult against Argentina, because they did play very organized. And it was a very tactical match, I think. So, well, anyhow, those are my 2 cents. Obviously, my views are very biased because I'm Dutch, so it probably doesn't mean much. MJ, too much info. Yeah, definitely. We got the video archive, so you can always take a look again. Absolutely. So, and no offense to Argentinians, by the way, if you are in here, congratulations. I mean, don't want to be a sour loser there, but congrats on that. It's just always difficult with penalties, I guess. I think that the fact that Holland used a different goalie with the penalties last time and didn't do it now was maybe a tactical weak point. There's nothing I think, the coach couldn't do anything at that point, but it did have a disadvantage, I think. But yeah, well. Well, folks, I will stop my rambling about football so I'm not boring you. Have a nice weekend indeed. Have a good football as well, the final and the third place if you're watching. And see you soon. Cheers.
Cheers, everyone. Bye for now.